that PowerPoint is visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll start the lecture. So I'll finish within 45 minutes, then we will discuss if you have any questions in between, okay? I think I have already started with the moment of inertia. Then I took two of lectures are just introduction. And hope you are now be here for, accustomed with this online system, okay? So today I am going to again discuss about this moment of inertia. And you people have learned this also in previous courses. But take derivation, I think we have covered, but I just take revision what we have done in the last lecture, okay? So we define the moment of inertia and we also wrote the equation for the definition of the moment of inertia. And you got it how it is defined and how this moment of inertia of a particular body depends on the two fundamental quantities, okay? One which we called as the mass of the body, and other we called it as the position, okay? Did you say the distance between the what? The center of the body to where the body is actually rotating, or you say the radius of particular rotation, okay? So that's the length arm you can define, okay? Of which that particular body is getting rotating. Okay, so these are the two fundamental quantities on which this moment of inertia of any particular body is depends. Okay, and we analogously write down this equation about what this particular length we called it as it is analogous to the what the inertia that we have in a translatory motion. Okay, this is the inertia we have for the rotational motion. Okay, so here we are going to define already defined, okay, just the revision what we define the coefficient of inertia for the rotational motion, okay, and that we called as a moment of inertia. So here this inertia of the body depends on fully on its mass, and therefore we measured in terms of the not fully depends on the mass, I say depends not only fully on the mass of the body but also depends on the effective distance of its particle from the axis of rotation. That's a very important, and that we called as a radius of gyration, okay? That effective distance of the particle masses from the axis of rotation, that we defined it as a effective distance, that we called it as a radius of gyration. Okay, so this radius of gyration, we defined it as a k over here, and this effective distance k we write down as a k. And but here I'm talking about this mathematical relation, that means moment of inertia you want to express in terms of the two quantities. You need to do the product of the mass of the body, and you need to make a square of the what this radius of gyration. Okay, so you if you make a moment of inertia, you have to write I is equal to mk square. Okay, and this effective distance k, how this relation mk square, that is the definition of the moment of inertia, we will discuss, okay, later on with the certain examples. Okay, so here effective distance k of particles of the body, that suppose you want to define, okay, you need to define only k, that is in, we called it as a radius of gyration about that axis. Okay, we need to define in terms of this k, what is it actually? So we write here the root mean square distance of the particle from the axis. Okay, just we have to write down the root mean square distance of the particle, and that we called as a square root of their mean square distance. Remember that it is equal to the square root of their mean square distance. Okay, that we define as a effective distance or the distance or effective distance of the particle from the axis of rotation, that we called as a radius of gyration. So hope you understand this quantity, and just a kind of revision to you. And remember that here we clear cut defined about the radius of gyration of the body. about any particular axis of rotation. Here we defined it as a distance from the axis at which the whole mass of the body were to be concentrated. And the moment of inertia of the rotation of the body about the axis of rotation would be same as the actual distribution of the masses. So here that standard K to be defined to be considered for considering all those masses of the that particular body is replaced by a center of mass. A center of mass is a position where we taken it as all the masses supposed to be concentrated, and this is the distance. And suppose there is a certain axis through which the body is rotating, so that distance x is a distance. Suppose you have here we called as the effective distance, that is a k, and that we k we written as a root of I upon m, okay, square root upon I upon m. I here it is defined as a moment of inertia. So that is a definition of the radius of gyration. So here I'll consider all the masses are supposed to be concentrated at the one point, and if you want to define the moment of inertia of such a body, okay, you just make a square root of this I upon m, okay, I to m, you just take a ratio and then you have to make a square root of that, that will give you the effective distance, that we called it as a k. So remember, here I'm talking about the rotation of the body, and which is the rotational body is in the rotational motion, and we called it as a particular distance as the radius of gyration, where we consider that all masses are to be replaced by a single mass. The distribution of all the masses are supposed to be concentrated to one position, and that position be taken that distance from the axis of rotation at the body is rotating around. Okay, and that we define as a effective distance. Okay, that the distance between that position to the position where the axis is the axis is defined over the axis at which the body is rotating. So remember that this is the very important terminology here. I'm talking about the rotating body, and there is a rotational motion, and there is a rotational motion around a certain axis of rotation. Here we need to define the moment of inertia of such a body. And the moment of inertia of such a body here we need to describe in two parameters. One is the position, the direction of the axis of rotation, and other is the distribution of the mass of the body about this that particular axis about which that rotation is happening. So remember, these are the two parameters we need to always consider when we need to define the moment of inertia of the body. Okay, I think you have done all these things. It just kind of, you know, the revision to your earlier course. Okay, but we'll definitely take some good problems on it later on. But since you are just accustomed with the syllabus, okay, I'll just taking some basic part here. So moment of inertia we define, we write its equation. We write this equation in terms of radius of gyration, okay, I is equal to mk square. And these expressions we already derived in the last lecture. So I'm not going to repeat that. You just write down all those on your notebook. And later on, once you have the team's ID and everything, okay, we will share you all the material later on. Okay, so don't worry. We define, actually we prove the two theorems of this particular plane lamina body. And when there is certain lamina body is there existing, and that rotation of that body about an axis, okay, and that axis is perpendicular to the plane of lamina. Okay, there are the two perpendicular axes which are there, okay, to that particular body, and they are right angles to each other. They are the perpendicular to the plane of the lamina and intersecting at in its own plane. These are they are the right angle, but they are right angles to each other and intersecting each other at the point where the perpendicular axis is passing through it. Okay, so that is a very important theorem, or you say the properties of such a body. Suppose you want to find out the resultant moment of inertia of a perpendicular axis. So this is called as a theorem of perpendicular axis, where we can define we can write down the resultant moment of inertia of such a laminar body where the two axes are also there passing of that particular lamina, and they are exactly right angles to each other, and they are in its own plane intersecting at a point, and where that point will be a where the actually the axis of that particular body is passing through it, and which is a perpendicular to that. So it is a perpendicular axis theorem, or the property, if you want to write down the resultant moment of inertia of such a planar lamina body at a perpendicular axis. Suppose here we define OX and OY are the two bodies over here is defined, which are lies in the plane of lamina, and they're intersecting at a point where these OX and OY are meeting each other. And that particular axis, which is a passing through this point O, is perpendicular to this particular lamina. So just lamina, it's just a laminar body. It's a plane laminar body we consider. Okay. And just like a disc you have, okay, have only its one plane like that. So the two axes which are perpendicular to each other, okay, and they're perpendicular to the point where they are meeting, and that perpendicular point, or you say the point through which the axis is passing, where this particular body is rotating around. Okay. So this Ix, Iy, we called as the moment of inertia of the individual axis Ox and Oy, but the axis which is passing through the point O intersecting these two, then the resultant moment of inertia will be the Ix plus Iy. And we got it, this relation, we used the definition of the moment of inertia. We individually written the moment of inertia for the individual X and Y axis, or you say OX and OY axis, by considering some particle of mass M, which is at the position M. Then we define the position of that point, okay, with respect to these two axes, and so on. We can write down the their addition of the individual moment of inertia as IX and IY, and using the definition, you can write the corresponding equation, that summation of Y square, summation of mx square and my square. These are the ix and iy, okay, and that we added as a y square plus x square, because m is a common over there, and that y square plus x square you can write down as r square with the help of the Pythagoras theorem. So here I am use this property to define the resultant moment of inertia, that is a summation of mr square, which is I is a moment of inertia of the whole plane laminar body. Suppose you are defining, okay, so that you want to define, so you need to define any particle, okay, that is at certain position, okay, and that is held at a distance. So you generally define the moment of inertia I as a mr square. So you can simply write down the addition Ix plus Iy as mr . So can we similarly put it another theorem that is called as a theorem of parallel axis, okay? And here again, we need to consider a two-dimensional body, and there is a statement that the moment of inertia of a body about an axis, which is that is axis is about a parallel axis, and basically is a passing a parallel. I mean to say the axis which is like there are, you want to consider the one axis which is rotating around, and there is one other axis which is parallel to this axis. So how the moment of inertia of the resultant because of the parallel axis is over there. Okay, so there are the two axes you can say, and you want to find out the resultant of moment of inertia because of the parallel axis. Okay, they are, and the body is rotating around that particular axis, okay, but we need to find out the resultant of moment of inertia if there is any axis, okay, which is also position, okay, of that particular axis. We need to find the moment of inertia, and that moment of inertia about a parallel axis through its center of mass should be added, and also one quantity is added, that is the product of the mass of the body and square of the distance between the two axes. So that is the resultant moment of inertia. If you want to write down for the parallel axis, you have to express in terms of moment of inertia of the center of mass of the body and the moment of inertia that we need to define for the distance between the two parallel axes. So that's what, if you have the axis which is a parallel to the axis of rotation, that distance between the two axes, you need to product with the mass, you need to square that distance product with the mass. That moment of inertia is also contributed when we are finding the resultant moment of inertia, because of the such a body when it is having, when we need to find out the moment of inertia about an axis parallel to the axis of rotation. Okay, so here remember what we did in this case also. We define the center of mass at a certain point. We consider again some body over here, plane laminar body. So two dimensionally we need to consider. Okay, so we generally the bodies are the always the three dimensional nature, but we want to just consider two dimensional picture. So you just have a body considered to be have a certain suppose we want to define, okay, moment of inertia for such a body. So we need to define a center of mass first. We need to write down the IC, that is the moment of inertia of a body about that particular position, that is center of mass. Okay, and that center of mass here we consider perpendicular to the plane of the paper. Okay, just like you have a body which has a mass m, moment of inertia IC, that is the moment of inertia about an axis passing through the point C. C is the center of mass, and that is the what generally just a mass, that is the axis which is passing through the center of mass, you just consider, which is a perpendicular to the plane of the paper where that particular body is holding. It's like the plane we consider, okay, and the axis which is about perpendicular to that. So here we need to define again the moment of inertia for the parallel axis, about the parallel axis to a certain distance. So here we define the r as a distance and at the position from the O, okay, which is defined r as a distance between the O and C over here, and we need to consider certain particle of mass m over here of that particular body, which is held at a distance x from the position O. So position O is like, you know, position of the parallel axis where the what we are going to find out the moment of inertia. So that's the distance. Suppose you have, just like you consider over there is a axis which is a parallel to that point O over there. Okay, so that position we consider O, and the moment of inertia of such a body about O, if you want to write down, so you just simply do what? The body is rotating around the distance x you consider, okay, so it is like x square, okay, and summation of all those mx square gives you the moment of inertia. So summation of mx square here I'm writing like the moment of inertia of the body which is about at a position O, okay, that is held at a distance x, that a particle we consider m, okay, from the parallel axis O, which is at the distance x. Okay, so we can write down the summation of all those masses multiplied by the distance square, that we can write down as I over there. Now this is a perpendicular PQ and OC. Suppose we want to prove, we need to prove over here what the parallel axis theorem is it actually. So we need to draw the perpendicular from the point P on you know, this OC which is extended to CQ. So PQ is a perpendicular, that is on OC you can say, and OC is extended further to point Q, so to join, you know, this particular and further we join the point PC over there. So PC is the P is the position where we consider a mass which is held at a certain, you know, that's a dash dash line over here it is drawn, that is the distance between that particular point from the center of mass of the body. Okay, so we need to consider simple geometry, since it is just remember arbitrary kind of body we consider a shape, so we always use the geometrical laws, and that is a cosine law, we can use it over here. Okay, and when we drop a perpendicular to PQ and OC produce and join a PC, okay, then can we use this triangle PCQ? Yes, correct, triangle PCQ. If you want to write down the OP square, sorry, not OPQ, sorry, OPQ, okay, then we need to write OP square as CP square plus OC square, correct, and twice of OC CQ, okay, twice of OC CQ. Now you can ask me how this equation come. This equation is come because of the cosine laws over there. So it is like you know, twice of cosine of theta, but that cosine as the what distance between this part P from the extended distance, but that extended distance is OC and CQ over there. Then they are in the same plane. So when they are in the same plane, exactly opposite. So it's like a cosine of pi, which is coming as a minus 180 degree. So this OCQ becomes a, that means cosine of an angle between the what? OCQ, that's the angle which becomes a minus. That's what here the sign becomes a plus over there. That's the simplification by the geometry. Okay. So cosine law being used over here to find out the OP distance. Okay. OP square we express in terms of OC and CQ. And that, that, that OC square plus the CP square is there. So CP square is, we need to multiply by this quantity with the M on both the sides. And when you multiply with the M with the CP square, M with the OC square and M with the OCCQ, okay. And I put it that value and write down those equations. We got a relation that is the I is equal to IC MR square twice of R summation of MCQ. So this particular quantity, summation of MCP square, we called as IC, that is the moment of inertia about the center of mass, because that CP is a distance of the mass from the center of mass position. And here the extra quantity which is coming, that is twice of R summation of MCQ. But that I explained you, this C is a position of all such a center of mass. When we considering the center of mass position, all the masses are supposed to be a concentrated at that point, okay, when we are considering the rotation of the body. So whatever be the distance product you are considering with the center of mass, okay, that effectively its value becomes zero, because this is the position you consider center of mass at the position and the body is rotating around that. Okay, so that distance is a zero over there. So MCQ ka product, that will be a zero over here. Okay, so this particular quantity, which is algebraic sum of the summation of all such a masses, they are concentrated at the center of mass. So with the distance CQ, that product will coming as a zero. Okay. So that's what only remaining quantity with your equation is I is equal to IC plus MR square. So I is equal to IC MR square. This is the equation of parallel axis. And you can write down the resultant moment of inertia about a parallel axis. About a parallel axis is equal to the moment of inertia of a body about its center of mass plus, and you say plus, or and you say the product of the mass of the body and the square of the distance between the two axis rotational, I mean to say about which axis we are taking its rotation. So that distance between the two axis, that is R over here, and the mass is the M is the mass of the body. So MR square plus IC will give you the value of I over there. So I'll just considering there are the two dimensional body, can the rule is applicable to the three dimensional one also. So basic vector, the cubic body, we just consider the three dimensional body, and we consider here, suppose imagine three dimensional bodies are there, and we need to find out the moment of inertia such a three dimensional body. So again, some geometrically you can find it out. How is to calculate the resultant moment of inertia of such a body when there is a parallel axis of, I mean to say there is a parallel axis and about which we need to find out the moment of inertia due to the parallel axis, which is holding at certain position. Okay. And which is a parallel to the axis of rotation. Remember that this is a very important thing. So here I'm just going to explain this three dimensional body. For that again, we need to consider some geometrical picture, and the geometrical picture will be clear to you in your mind is over here is like that. We need to draw a parallel axis. That is the one axis which is we called as AB, another one which we called as CD. Okay. So, and there where we called as imagine a certain particle which is held at a certain position, that is point P. And this is actually the axis is A, B, and C, the axis, you say, they are perpendicular to this position. So we need to draw the perpendicular distances from the position P, you say, or point P, okay? And we know, remember, we need to consider here this, the distance between the two axes are R, okay? You say the distance between two parallel axes, small r over there, okay? So can we write down the PK and PL? So just please draw this geometry so you will understand on your notebook. P, sir. K, yes?
No, as we did in the second dimension, can we just consider plates as like two-dimensional bodies and just stack them up?
Yes, we can do that, okay, no problem. You mean to say here, instead of doing like this derivation and make it like three-dimensional, like you are asking me?
Or sir, I'm just asking, let's consider a body and perpendicular to that, we will just slice up some plates. Basically, in the two-dimensional, how the axis were going through the plates perpendicular, similar to that, we are just making plates. We can just consider them as plates and we can then add the moment of inertia of them. So the total moment of inertia, then we can use the two-dimensional formula for the three-dimensional condition, because it's not wrong, because a plate, it has it can be considered as 2D object, and we can apply the formula and we can just pile up the moment of inertia.
Yes, that way also no problem, it's correct. This is the way. Given a proof, okay, you just pile up and you can write down, okay, but I'll just use a geometrically, okay, how we can write down the resultant moment of inertia for the parallel axis, right? So that is the this particular case we are studying over here, but you can apply, that is no problem, that the rule will remain same, okay? Just we need to understand how been proved over here, okay, for a particular case, like just you consider the three-dimensional picture, so it's just a cubic picture where the two axes are, just parallel to each other, and we need to consider some particle which is held at some point P, and we need to consider that particular point which is perpendicular. I mean to say the perpendicular, you need to draw the two axes over there, and simply use the law of cosine, you can. You can get the same equation that we need for the two-dimensional case. So I'll just give you the proof. Hope you will understand. This is not been so much complicated. Okay. Consider over here is a particle which has a small mass m, and that is at position P over there. And you have a two axis AB and CD. So PK and PL are the perpendicular drawn from point A to AB and CD respectively. And we just extended that KL, that distance between the two axes, to a certain point T, where we can draw the exact perpendicular to some point T over there, which is at PT, okay, that's the perpendicular. So perpendicular, we drop from the point P to extended part on this axis, okay, and that particular point PT is a perpendicular to position, and that particular T is, which is at small x from the axis of rotation. Okay. Now this is the distance we need to consider PL, that is the distance which we draw the perpendicular on the axis of rotation, and that distance is small d. LK, that is distance between the two parallel axes. Okay. That is R, and LT, that is the extended what we called or you say that perpendicular, that is from the position P to a point, okay, on the distance that we extended to have a point T over there, and which gives me the distance, perpendicular, which is at the point P, which is held at a distance X from the axis of rotation. Okay, so this is the three-dimensional, which is a body you can consider, and PLK, that is the angle between PL and K. At K and L, I'm talking about the points where the this is the positions where we consider K and L are the positions where we draw for drawing the perpendicular of certain position where we consider a mass small m over there. So that angle we consider over here as a theta, PLK, which is the angle we consider as a theta over here. So I be the moment of inertia of the body that is about AB, that is about the parallel axis of rotation we call, and CD, that is the axis, we called as a moment of inertia axis. Okay, that we consider all the particles are supposed to be considered at that point, and the axis which is passing through the moment of inertia position we called as a and the moment of inertia at that point, I mean to say the center of mass, we defined it as IC over there. So we defined I in terms of that distance, that is the I is equal to summation of pk square. Why it is a summation of, it is not a whole, it's a pk and product, pk distance. So pk is like a perpendicular distance of the point P to the axis of rotation, you call parallel axis of rotation. And IC, that is the moment of inertia, which is passing through the center of mass, this is summation of mass m, all those masses summation of m multiplied by pl square. So pl is a perpendicular to that point p to l where the that center of axis is passing through. Okay, and that we can't write down as a summation of md square, since we consider that pl square is a d over there, so pl square becomes a d square over there. Use over here again the law of cosine to write down the pk square value in terms of, you know, the law of cosine, that's a you know, this is the law of cosine by the geometry. So if you have this particular angle, okay, and we know that this particular angle of theta, if you want to write down, okay, you just use the geometry over there for this particular PKL. So this is your P, this is your P, sorry, this is your K, and this is your L over there. So you use that geometry to find out the distance of PK square in terms of, yes, hope you have the geometry, PK square, that's a perpendicular distance, the hypotenuse kind of a thing, okay, you are measuring with the help of the law of cosine. So law of cosine, if you use it, pk square is equal to d square plus r square twice rd cosine of theta, and this is the right angle triangle PTL you have. Okay, we can write down cosine of PLT. Okay, so you have, you can just see this is the PLT. Okay, this is the right angle triangle. So if you want to find out the cosine of theta over there, that is what? LT upon PL. Okay, that is the adjacent triangle. Okay, adjacent side divided by hypotenuse. That is the cosine of PLT. Okay, so the geometry we use over here to write down the equation and cosine. This is the cos of 180 degree minus theta. Okay, that is the what angle PLT. Angle PLT, if you want to find out the angle PLT over there, okay, suppose you define as this as a theta over there, so it is remaining will be a 180 minus theta over there. Okay, so this is like a LP, which is a perpendicular over here. Okay, look, not looks like in three dimensional, but it's a it is the angle. If you want to find out PLT magnitude, okay, that is a PLT magnitude, it's a 180 degree minus the PLK over there. And that PLK value over here, look at, this is the PLK. So hope your understanding is, this is the particular thing if you want to write down, okay. If I want to find out this angle, okay. So I want to subtract, okay, this much angle. So you can write down the cosine of, you know, 180 minus of that theta, that becomes a angle PLK over there. Hope you are agree with the geometry, and that is angle PLT is a cos of 180 minus PLK, and that PLK we write down over here as a theta. Okay, and this particular cosine of 180 minus theta, again we use this theorem, okay, that is LT upon PL. So LT distance is over here the x, okay, and the PL distance is the D, so we can write down as a X upon D. So this D cosine of theta is a minus of X over there, we can write down. Cosine of minus, 180 minus theta is a minus cosine of theta, that the geometry equation, we can use it over here and write down this as a D cos theta as a X. So D cos theta value, you got it at X over there, and this, substitute this value in the expression of the PK square, that will give you the value of, you know, pk square. So pk square, this is not the whole pk whole square, remember that. Pk square means pk whole square, that is a d square r square plus twice rx. Okay, so this moment of inertia about this pk square, you want to find out, you just multiply summation of those masses into a pk whole square. Okay, and this pk square will be a, that you got it from the equation as a d square plus r square plus twice rx. Okay, you just do the multiplication, and again there is one quantity which is a similar quantity that is happens in our earlier equation. Okay, and that is a quantity which talks about the summation of all those masses and the distances of the parallel axis, you know, from the all those masses, which is the where that axis is held, okay, at a certain position. So remember that at the same point when we consider summation, the resultant product, or you say the product of mass into a x, okay, so all the masses that got distributed at various distances, so if you sum is increasing, sum is decreasing, so when we take a summation of all those m into x, your value will become zero. So this way you can write down this twice as summation x will be get cancelled. The only quantity which is the remaining our center of mass of the whole body, about a plane laminar body, but that is another axis over where the body is holding, okay, at certain position which is parallel to that. So that parallel axis, which is the position at the parallel axis, if you want to find out the resultant of moment of inertia, we need to know the moment of inertia about the center of mass of the body, and we need to know the distance between the two parallel axes over there. So we need to know the mass of the body. Okay, so mass of the body, distance between the two axes, that mr square will give you the that added with the moment of inertia of the center of mass gives me the moment of inertia of the whole body. Okay, so this is the way the calculations of the moment of inertia of a particular body been calculated. And you know, we can use this for any particular body. The body may be a rod, may be a spherical kind of a body, may be a cylindrical, may be a any kind of a shape, but which maintains symmetry over there. And we need to consider the rotation about its you know, perpendicular or parallel. We can use these laws over there, and we can find out the resultant moment of inertia of such a body. So here we always consider a continuous, homogeneous, then we can use summation, integration, and so on. Okay, it is not like a discrete body. So we consider the symmetries to be maintained, the homogeneity, the substance or the material which will it is made up of. Okay, it is remains same throughout. So we need to consider the calculation for determination of the moment of inertia with the help of the expressions those we derived with the help of the perpendicular and the parallel axis theorems, right? So we need to adopt such a things, and I can ask you this question: what will be the dimensions, what will be the units about the moment of inertia if you need to measure? So what is the dimensions? The dimensions of mass and dimensions of the distance. So that dimensions can be used for making, you know, MLT system, ML square. Okay, that is the dimensions of the mass and the square of distance, the ml square. Okay, will no time over there, t is zero, only m1 l2. okay, you can say. And the SI unit is a kg meter square, mass ka unit kg hai, length ka unit meter hai. So but when you are on to putting in the cgs units, okay, you need to consider the practical unit, that is the gram is a practical unit, and the radius of gyration, that is to be measured in centimeter. CGS are units are generally used for the bulky practical point of view. We always use the CGS units. Okay, so gram centimeter square will be the CGS units of your moment of inertia. The rotation that we consider about a particular body, it is unaffected by reversing the direction of the body, so it is a scalar quantity. So the total moment of inertia of such a body is about a given axis of rotation will be equal to the sum, S-U-M, sum of their individual moment of inertia about that axis. Exactly similar we consider over the symmetry of the body. So whether you deflect the body along the anti-clockwise, suppose you have a spherical, a shell, or you consider a disk over there, and it is rotating around the common center of axis. So we need to just consider this is a scalar, which is unaffected by the what? The directions over here. So remember, this is scalar. It has a dimensions ml square, and it has a unit kg meter square. In SI unit, MKS unit you call, and CGS units are the gram centimeter square. So I think I have revised the last lecture again here, repetition kind of a thing, but I can apply these things to one certain body. So like just you have a thin uniform rod, and here we need to determine the moment of inertia of such a thin uniform rod you have, and you need to find out the moment of inertia about an axis through its center and perpendicular to its length. So remember that the position is very important, which is the axis you are considering over there, what kind of body you have, your uniform rod, which has certain length, which has certain mass, and which is rotating around in a certain axis, and that axis is perpendicular to its length. Okay. And that we need to derive over here the formula for the moment of inertia of such a body, where we need to position that particular axis passing through its center and perpendicular to its length. Okay. So it is a special case we are deriving this moment of inertia. So we need to consider there are the masses to be equally distributed, and the mass per unit length for such a body we can define as simply by definition mass divided by small l. So that small l is the length of the body, and just we write down the moment of mass per unit length. Mass per unit length. Okay. So mass per unit length means mass divided by its length. Okay. Like that is the mass per unit length. So consider a small element. Now we need to derive for the whole body how it is the moment of inertia. Such a thin uniform rod. Thin uniform rod has a certain mass, but has certain thickness. Thin uniform rod. Whenever you say thin, it has a certain thickness. But we consider the perpendicular axis over here. We need to position that perpendicular. So CD is a perpendicular which is passing through a certain position O over there, and we need to consider a small element of this rod of a certain length dx. Then we are considering that it has a length dx over there. Okay. Or you call a small element which has a position where we can small element instead of small l, we consider a small dx integral infinity means small distance which is at a distance, and that is held at a certain distance which we called as small x over there from the position O where this perpendicular axis is passing through that. Okay. So mass is clearly equal to m by l into dx. So you just multiply mass per unit length, you multiply by the dx, you will give the total mass. Okay. And the moment of inertia we just define in terms of this particular mass, that m by l into dx into x square, that is the distance of the small dx from the what? The position of the axis at O over there. Okay, so O at axis O, or you say the axis at O, the moment of inertia will be m by l dx x square. Okay, so the moment of inertia of the whole rod you want to write down. So how can you write down? So you need to consider that is a certain position you consider dx over there, and which is at the position x over there, but you need to find out the moment of inertia of the whole body. Okay. So what you do, you need to remember that this is the axis which is passing from at the center. Okay. So from the center, suppose the body has a length L. So one end should be at the L by 2 and other end is at the what? The L by 2. Okay. Getting my point. So this is the two distances or the positions you can say that this particular body is held. I mean to say the ends of these rods are at the L by 2 from the mean. But if you want to derive the distances, the limits of the integration, you can put minus L by 2 to plus L by 2 in the integration, or you can take twice of 0 to L by 2. You just take a twice multiplication with the integration 0 to L by 2. That is the limits of integration. You can put it and you can just solve the value of ML x square dx. You can integrate and you can get the value. Okay, you can solve with the limits of integration, I say, minus L by 2 to plus L by 2 also. Okay, but that is exactly the symmetry is maintaining the the axis which is passing to the center of the body. So you can write down twice of, you know, this 0 to L by 2, that's the limits. The initial limit is 0 and the final limits you take L by 2. And just take the, that because of the include both halves of the rod, you say. Okay, so you can just solve this integration. You will get this final quantity. You people have done it. And hopefully the integration is not so much difficult for you people. And this is a preliminary requirement to find out the moment of inertia of a homogeneous kind of a thin uniform rod, which is held at a, you know, and that is rotating. That is a position about an axis, and that axis is a passing, but perpendicular to its length. Okay, so remember, this is the moment of inertia, ml square by 12, that you calculated that value of an thin uniform rod, okay? But what that is about an axis passing through that center and perpendicular to its length, okay? So this is a very special case we studied. Can we use this law to the what? The perpendicular axis. I means you have another axis, sir, which is a, yes.
Sir, in the derivation, why are we considering the mass to be m upon l into dx?
Look at now. Just you consider this is the complete body is m over there. Okay. What I mean to say, the distribution. This is the integral way we need to solve such a problem. Okay. The one method is what you do. You just take a small infinitesimal mass per unit length and you just, you know, added all those masses to make a complete mass like a m over there. So we consider instead of whole length, we divide into small part, that is the mass per unit length, okay? And small part, if you integrate it to apply to the whole body, you can get the total mass. So this is like, you know, you just distributed the mass in terms of the length and you multiply with the small length element again, that again will give you the infinitesimal small, or you say the infinitesimal small mass of that particular particle which is holding at that position, like you consider. Okay, so that is what we are doing, this m by l into dx, nothing more on that. Okay, and the thing is like that, you can apply such an integral continuous bodies, homogeneous bodies, okay? So you can apply such an integration, such a bodies, okay, which are, you know, symmetrically and uniform over there. So I think it's no question. I hope you got it to the point, okay, what I mean to say. Okay, m by l into dx. So small things to be pointed out for that small moment of inertia for small things, and just do integration for the whole things, okay, over the limits. Okay, so I can apply this thing to
sir, how can we decide whether a body is laminar or not?
Plane laminar body, or you say laminar body, not laminar, means what we can say that a particular lamina, you can say consider the plane, okay, of such a bodies. Whatever be the perpendicular, if you want to draw any axes, okay, they should be on its same plane. We called it as a laminar body. If any axis which you drawn, okay, are passing for which the body is rotating, okay, they are on the other plane, okay, not on the same plane. We called that body is not in a laminars. Okay, all the planes are not in a. So suppose the body is rotating, so they should be in a one plane it is rotating, not the other plane. That's talking about the laminars. Okay.
Thank you. Okay, sir.
So the axes that we considering always, they are in the same plane. They are not to be coming from the other planes. That's the talking about the laminars. Okay. That's the laminar bodies. So the treatment here for finding out the moment of inertia about a parallel like axis theorem that you applied, here we applied, there is a perpendicular to its length. That is a axis which is rotating perpendicular to its length now, okay, about an axis, okay, you can have that. So the treatment here is the same, except we need to pass that CD not at the center, we need to pass at one of its end over there. Okay, so when you are applying one of its end, we need to know that, okay, what is the moment of inertia of finding the moment of inertia of such a body here. But the distance over here from the, you know, the center, which becomes L by 2 over there, okay, and the whole body which is at the like L over there, okay. So here what we consider, here is the passes through one end B, and the expression we need to derive from the x is equal to 0 and to held at a distance which is at L over at the point A over there, okay. So the distance between these two, A and B, is always B L over there. So limits of integration here we need to find it out, that is the L, okay, not L by 2 here in this case, okay. So, but the distance small x, that is the x we consider here, that is from the position that we consider from the one end, not from the center, the axis, because here the axis which is held at the end of the rod, okay. So remember that from which positions you are finding the moment of inertia, that's are important. That's to say, moment of inertia is just not the mass, it's the position where we are doing all such a calculation. So that integration of 0 to L we need to do over here, because this A and B are held together at a distance L over there. So the moment of inertia that is we are finding is ML square by 3. Similar results you can obtain when you can use the theorem of parallel axis. And that is a similar, that the moment of inertia due to the perpendicular axis, that is ML square by 12, and you just take the one end distance, that is L by 2 from the center of mass, you just square it, multiply by the mass, you will get the same answer, that is ML square by 3. So this is again the same thing we did, okay, but it's a kind of application over here with the thin uniform rod. So I'll just stop over here. You have maybe the second lecture. So we will discuss any questions in the next lecture. Okay, so I'll stop here. Thank you.
Sir, when we will get access to this PDF or this PPT?
I will give